Welcome, welcome, welcome to the studios here in Rosonsea, the studios of Every Creature Commission Television, live streaming at ecctv.org, or you could be watching us on the YouTube channel Every Creature Commission TV. We welcome you all. This is the very first edition today of what God has called us to do, bring about a ministry of tears. So welcome, welcome, welcome to the Midnight Cry and its ministry of tears.
Mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call. Jesus Christ.
Coming again in the clouds, dear viewers and listeners. He's coming again for the quick and the dead and the living. In him, hallelujah, he's coming again. And that's what this program is all about. And it's also about the love and the compassion of the Lord for the lost. He wants all to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. For he is the true light of the world. He is the true light of the world. In the light of the world, there is no darkness. And there is nothing done in secret. There is nothing done in the darkness of evil that will not be brought into his glorious light. He is our protector, our preserver, our provider. Welcome to this first edition, as you heard earlier, of the Midnight Cries Ministry of Tears, the end time outpouring of the Holy Spirit accompanied by the true word of God to all nations. For the gospel, in the words of Matthew 24, the words of Jesus, shall be preached to all nations, and then the end shall come. This is your presenter, Lindsay Griffiths, singing and speaking to you in this program. In the studio with me is David Griffiths, who you will meet shortly, and the dear sisters, praying women, prayers. Many years they've been missionaries as well to the third world. Hallelujah. Fulfilling the Sri Lanka to Tibet vision given to us from the Lord. These dear sisters are Margaret Dransfield and Marjorie Bynum. Glory to God. This is going to be a great outpouring today and a great encouragement. Let me just talk to you after this next song. I will talk to you a bit about God's provision, because he sees what's coming. He knows the end from the beginning, and he always makes provision in times of plenty and times of lack, as you will see. So therefore, we shouldn't be afraid. We shouldn't be afraid for tomorrow. Jesus said that himself, take no thought for the morrow. We shouldn't be afraid to preach the word in season and out of season, including especially to the lost. Here's the song that tells us why we need to have no fear, because he lives.
Because I know,
oh,
greater still. The calm assurance this child can face uncertainties because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then a stir gives way to victory. I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow, because he lives. Oh, fear is gone, because I know.
Yes, I know.
He holds a future,
and life
is worth the living just because he lives.
Yes,
life is worth the living just because he lives.
Yes, he is the Prince of Life, dear viewers and listeners. Remember what the Apostle Peter said in the book of Acts. He said he preached the word of God after the great outpouring on the day of Pentecost. And he said to those gathered to hear him in Jerusalem, he said, "You killed the Prince of Life. You didn't know what you were doing, but you killed the Prince of Life. But he rose again, and it's through his power and in his name that we have just healed the lame man at the gate beautiful." That's what he said. You see, he is the Prince of Life as well as the Prince of Peace. Glory to his name. And he knows the end from the beginning. He is Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Prince of Life, the Creator. And he has a plan. He always has a plan, because he knows what's coming. You see, he knows that we're living in the last days. He's given us the signs to look out for. He spoke all those years ago, 2,000 years ago, when he was on earth. He spoke to his disciples and he warned them. And he gave visions and words to those who wrote down, inspired by the Holy Spirit. In this word, the word of God, the Bible, they wrote down what he told them and gave them signs and visions of the end times. He gave them to Peter, who wrote the epistles, 1st and 2nd Peter. He gave them to Jude, who was probably his half-brother, by the way. He gave him a powerful word of what was going to happen in the end times. These are just a few people, but above all, the one whom he loved the most of all, the beloved disciple and apostle John. He wrote the book of Revelation about the end times. And also in his epistles, he talked about the Antichrist and many Antichrists that would come and testing the spirits. All the signs of the times are written cover to cover in this book, because also others in the Old Testament have talked about them. In Isaiah, in Ezekiel, to name but two, have talked about the end times. Daniel especially talks about the end times. So you see, God has a provision, as he did at the beginning with Noah in Genesis. He talks about, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. Look at Matthew 24, viewers and listeners. See it for yourselves. Matthew 24 talks about this. You see, God, in the beginning, gave Noah the pattern for a physical ark, an actual huge boat that would carry, that would be a haven of rest and refuge for Noah and his family and the birds and animals chosen as well to survive the flood. And he gave a covenant to Noah to say that there would be no more such floods on the earth to destroy the earth. He did say that. And he gave Noah the rainbow in the sky as the first covenant. You see, that rainbow, dear viewers and listeners, is a covenant from God. It's not meant to be put on flags for gay liberation and gay pride march and thrown down the steps of York Minster. It's actually a rainbow from God, a sign that he would not again destroy the earth, and forever summer and winter and springtime and harvest would go on. You see, now in these end times, as we'll read again soon, God has provisioned a spiritual ark for people to take refuge and to ride above the storms of the last days. Amen. Let's get our priorities right now and turn to Jesus in this song. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than horses or land. I'd rather be laid by his nail-pierced hand than to be the queen of a vast domain, or be held in sacred sway. I'd
for Jesus than anything this world affords today. This world affords today. Yes, wouldn't you rather have Jesus? A lasting, lasting inheritance, everlasting. Our Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Glory to his name. You see, he knows, he's got the provision, he's got the plan. I'd like to look at this scripture right now. If you look with me at the book of Genesis, the first book of the Bible, chapter 41. It's about Joseph and Pharaoh in Egypt. Joseph was a righteous man, if you'd remember. He was the favorite son of the 12 children of Jacob, later known as Israel, from whence comes the 12 tribes. Now Joseph is a type of Jesus. You see, the Old Testament is full of what Bible scholars and people who study the word called typology. That means there are many, many people in the Old Testament, including Moses and Joseph, who, and Daniel, who are types or foreshadowings of the Lord Jesus. They are not, of course, the same as him, because he's the only begotten Son of God. But they are prophets and great men of God, beloved of the Lord. He talks about them being beloved. Daniel is beloved. He's called the beloved. You know, he's called the beloved. And so are many of the others. Moses was the friend of God. King David as well was beloved. His name means beloved. But here is how God provides in a 7-year plan. And if you want to read more about God's 7-year plan for these days, these end times, 7-year spiritual plan, God's business plan, just go to ECC TV, to our website, or any of our other websites. They'll be at the end of the program, and you'll be able to look up the 7-year plan. It's on the screen now, sorry. The mighty producer, who's about to come and preach to us soon, David Griffith, he has just pointed out that the 7-year plan is in. Now look, let's look at the 7-year plan of God given in Genesis 41, where Pharaoh has a dream and no one can interpret this dream except Joseph. So suddenly they remember Joseph. Now Joseph has spent years as a slave and in Egypt, and he was sold as a slave by his own brothers. He spent years in Egypt as a slave. He spent years in prison, falsely accused by a Jezebel, namely the wife of Potiphar, the captain of Pharaoh's guard, if I remember, Potiphar. And she had falsely accused Joseph of attacking her, trying to sexually molest and attack her. So he ended up in prison. Even in prison, he rose. You see, he rose to preeminence, for his spirit of excellence and godliness shone out from the other prisoners. He was put in charge of the other prisoners. He then met two people who worked for Pharaoh, Pharaoh's butler and Pharaoh's baker. And he actually interpreted the dream they had had, and exactly that was fulfilled, because Joseph also had a prophetic ministry and was an interpreter of dreams. And here at long last, after some years, Pharaoh's butler remembers, oh, this is terrible. I forgot about Joseph. I left him in prison when I meant to tell him, to get him released, to help him get released. I forgot about him. So he tells Pharaoh about Joseph, and Joseph comes and interprets this dream. But Joseph is brought hastily out of prison. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, this is verse 15 of Genesis 41. I have dreamed a dream, and there is none that can interpret it. And I have heard say of thee that thou canst understand a dream to interpret it. You see, Joseph and Daniel, both great men of God, both types of Christ, they could interpret dreams that no one else, none of the soothsayers or the sorcerers or the magicians could do. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, it is not in me. God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. That's the first thing you see. It's not that we glorify ourselves. It's that we let God work through us and give him the glory. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, in my dream, behold, I stood upon the bank of the river. And behold, there came up out of the river seven kine cows, fat, fleshed, and well favored. And they fed in a meadow. And behold, seven other kine came up after them, poor and very ill favored, and lean fleshed, such as I never saw in all the land of Egypt for badness. And the lean and the ill favored kine did eat up the first seven fat kine. And when they had eaten them up, it could not be known that they had eaten them, but they were still ill-favored, as at the beginning. So I awoke, and I saw in my dream, and behold, 7 ears came up in one stalk, ears of corn, right? Full and good, and behold, 7 ears withered, thin, and blasted with the east wind, sprang up after them. And the thin ears devoured the seven good ears. And I told this unto the magicians, but there was none that could declare it unto me. And Joseph said unto Pharaoh, the dream of Pharaoh is one. God has showed Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good kine are 7 years. And the seven good ears are 7 years. The dream is one. And the seven thin and ill-favored kine that came up after them are 7 years. And the seven empty ears blasted with the east wind shall be 7 years of famine. This is the thing which I have spoken unto Pharaoh. What God is about to do, he showed unto Pharaoh. Behold, there come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt. And there shall arise after them 7 years of famine. And all the plenty shall be forgotten in the land of Egypt. And the famine shall consume the land. And the plenty shall not be known in the land by reason of that famine following, for it shall be very grievous. And for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice. It is because the thing is established by God, and God will shortly bring it to pass. Now therefore, let Pharaoh look out a man discreet and wise, and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh do this, and let him appoint officers over the land, and take up the fifth part of the land of Egypt in the seven plenteous years. And let them gather all the food of those good years that come, and lay up corn under the hand of Pharaoh, and let them keep food in the cities, and that food shall be for store to the land against the 7 years of famine, which shall be in the land of Egypt, and the land perish not through the famine. And the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh, and in the eyes of all his servants. You see, these are the words of the Lord, dear viewers and listeners. And all that God says is good. And God not only saved the land of Egypt through this, because as you probably know, Pharaoh appointed Joseph because there was a spirit of excellence in him, as with Daniel too in later years. There was a spirit of excellence. He knew he could trust Joseph. He knew that God was with him. So he appointed him as this wise and discreet man. And Joseph, saved through the word of God and through the instruction of God, saved the land of Egypt from famine by wisely storing the corn and all the other things that were needed for the 7 years of famine. And God not only used Joseph to save Egypt, but also he had compassion working through Joseph. Compassion for his dear aged father, Jacob or Israel, and for his brothers, even his own brothers. Many of these brothers were the ones that had thrown him into this pit and had deceived their own father by Joseph's coat of many colors. They dipped it in blood of a dead animal that he killed and they gave it to him. So, oh, we're really sorry, but Joseph's been killed probably by wild animals. Oh dear. And they lied to him. They deceived his own father. And many of them even wanted to kill him. But Reuben, the oldest brother, stopped them. He wanted to go back and rescue Joseph. But by then he'd gone, taken away to be sold as a slave. Joseph had every reason to have a grudge against his family, but he didn't, you see, because the compassion of the Lord was working through Joseph, not only for his adopted countrymen in Egypt, but for his real family, his far from perfect family back in Israel, in the land where they'd come from. Because the famine was grievous there as well. They were desperate for food. They were desperate. They were starving. And so it came about that God, through his plan, his seven-year plan, and the 7 good years and the 7 years of famine, he brought it about that Joseph saved the lives of those from Israel, those of his own family, the fathers, the patriarchs, the fathers of the tribes of Israel. Hallelujah. He saved them. He showed them compassion. Yes, he tested them. He tested their loyalty. He tested them to the limit, as God tests us to the limit. He tested them and he tried them. But then he wept over them. The compassion of God overwhelmed him. And he was reconciled to his family whose lives he'd saved. You see, there's no end to God's compassion. There's no end to his provision. But the signs of the times need to be interpreted, read, and obeyed. And this is so important in these last days. And before the next part of the program, this is a link to the ministry of tears, you see. You see, God does far over and above what we can possibly imagine. You see, if Joseph hadn't been there, who would have interpreted the dream of Pharaoh? Would not the whole of Egypt have starved, and the whole of the known world, and all these people in Israel, as well as family, wouldn't they have? God had his man there. God's timing is perfect, isn't it? You see how he could work through just one man who was willing to pay the price, Joseph. He was willing to pay the price of all the suffering and all the pain and everything, all those years of agony, willing to walk in forgiveness, wisdom and discretion and love and compassion. He is a type of Christ Jesus. You see, whether you look at these are both examples from Genesis. Whether you look at the seven-year dream, the seven-year plan of God revealed through through his servant, Joseph, or whether you look at the Ark of Noah, again, God's plan specifically given in great detail to Noah at a time when it never even rained on the earth and nobody had ever seen a boat, ever. But God gave that salvation plan to dear Noah, and he obeyed in spite of all the mockery and all the hard work and the toil and the years of agony he went through. You see, these are all types of things to come. And in these last days, he still has his compassion, his provision, his plan, his spiritual ark. And he's calling, come, I am the haven of rest. My soul in sad exile was out on life's sea, so burdened with sin and distressed, till I heard a sweet voice saying, make me your choice, and I entered the haven of rest. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide sea no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the world's stormy deep, but in Jesus I'm safe evermore. I yielded myself to his tender embrace, and faith taking hold of the word, my fetters fell and I anchored my soul. The haven of rest is my Lord. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide seas no more. The tempest may sweep o'er the world's stormy deep, but in Jesus I'm safe evermore. I've anchored my soul in the haven of rest. I'll sail the wide seas no more. But in Jesus I'm safe evermore. In Jesus I'm safe evermore. Dear viewers and listeners, he's our haven of rest. And now,
Lindsay, before you introduce me, there's a very important announcement. I've got a poster from the Revival Christian Worship Center over there in India, Trichy, Tamilnadu, India. And it's about our dear, dear friends. Pastor Jacob, his wife Susie, went to be with the Lord coming up to 1 year ago. And next Saturday at the Revival Christian Worship Center in Trichy, Tamil Nadu, there is a special anniversary memorial service. Everyone can see the details on the screen just now. And everyone is invited, wherever you are in the world, if you can get to Trichy, that's Trichipally in Tamil Nadu next Saturday. There is a special memorial service from a lady we knew very well, Susie.
Wonderful lady. Wonderful couple.
So we praise the Lord. We can announce this today. The dear Pastor Jacob sent me this poster to tell you all of this wonderful lady and the special first anniversary memorial service, which will take place at the Revival Christian Worship Center in Trichy, where we all have been here. And we give Jesus all the praise and all the glory.
We do indeed.
Hallelujah.
Bless him. And he needs our prayers, you know.
Praise
the
Lord.
It's a hard walk for him.
It is. My dear, dear Lindsay, talk about ministry of tears. The battlegrounds you go through if you're a real Christian. If it doesn't move you to tears at times, then I doubt your Christianity. For the whole of this work is a ministry of tears. And it's what the body is called to do, is to cry and weep over the loss, so that the lost ones can come into the kingdom and be saved from the fires of hell. That doesn't stir you to tears. Nothing will. For it's the heart of God that none should be lost, that all should be saved. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lindsay, for the ministry there. You're watching our new program, The Midnight Cries Ministry of Tears. The Lord told us to extend this program to bring the heart of God. After Lindsay has broken down the barriers through the praise and worship, when we were just doing the midnight cry, it was as if then something more needed to happen. And that, of course, is the preaching of the word. And praise and worship so important. And Lindsay's done this so wonderfully. The heart of God being reached. Lovely, beautiful song she sings. But there's nothing quite like the preaching of the word of God. Not because it's me, it's because it's God. He longs to get out his word, and his word is life. These words are life unto those who find them. Healing to all their flesh. And as I bend down and get my Bible, we praise you, Lord Jesus, that the victory is ours in his name. That the joy of the Lord is our strength, yes. But as we come to the very last of the end days, it's as if something is happening. We're going to be covering more of this tomorrow in our new program, On Fire, Constitution Keepers. It's as if God has led us to reach a higher level with our programming, as if the time is so short that we need to understand and bring to the attention of the people that those who are the remnants of God, who understand the things of God, are going through so much battleground at this time, that those receiving the word are bringing about the conditions for a revival, yet the old devil wants to keep it down as much as he can. And as you see on our screen, you'll see the Midnight Cry Ministry of Tears, the encouragement to look at the seven-year plan God has given us. Stage one is Jeremiah 1:10. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out, to pull down, to destroy, to throw down. And the emerging church has come in, destroying that which founders set up, turning things upside down, not as the word says we should turn things upside down, but turning things upside down to the way of the devil and his unbelief through higher criticism and false Eastern mystical practices, which is what's being witnessed in Elam, Assemblies of God, the Apostolic Church. I will not hold back from this. We will pull these denominations down in the name of Jesus, so as we can build them up in the vision of their founders. So those of you in Elam, get ready for the restoration of the vision of George Jeffreys. In the Assemblies of God in UK, of Howard Carter, of Charles Harden, of Smith Wigglesworth, and of the Apostolic Church, you have moved away from the vision of D.P. Williams, and God is judging you for it. You were called to stay in Pentecost, and you disobeyed the prophetic word. So hell be upon you in the name of Jesus. For God is looking to restore. He changes not. Remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set. So this stage one of this business plan, the economy of souls, is all about pulling down that which is infiltrated in. We have governments in America and Britain who know not of the constitutions of God. God has given these nations and Commonwealth countries too. They know not of what God has called us to do. They know not of forsaking and covenant. We have a legal case on at this time on the issue of forsaking. When a lady gave all she had over her choice in the Lord, so as to bring the conditions for every creature to be reached. Yet there are those in government who know have no idea of what covenant is. Yet they swear on a Bible so as to be an MP. They swear in the courts of law so as to tell the truth, but they have no idea what's in the book. Well, we've read the book. We have no idea in this country what's in the coronation service. And the emphasis on the sons of Zadok, the priesthood of Zadok, rather than Eli. When you say these things to government officers, they look at you as if you are stupid. Yet it's the constitution of the nation. So we're here to bring down that which is infiltrated into nations, infiltrated into church movements. This is part one. You can see it at ecctv.org. Also, we've just launched, it's online at this moment, constitutionkeepers.org. There are so many constitution breakers out there. Lord said, be the remnant to be a keeper. Bring the message of the keeper to the people. constitutionkeepers.org. And this stage two of this plan, the ministry of tears. Oh, how God has called us to weep over the lost. How God has called us to be in such a position that we can understand the suffering of the people. And how God has called us to fulfill this mighty calling in His name. To move on from the pulling down to the building up. How do we build up? Through the ministry of tears. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, he said this in chapter 3 and verse 14, to turn, O backsliding children, you AOG leaders today, you Elam leaders, you Nazarene leaders, you Baptist leaders, you have taken your movements away from the landmark of the founders, and you have been found out in the name of Jesus. Those who have taken over the Bible College of Wales building in Swansea, you have no idea the original vision of Rees Howes. I do. My dad was there in the 1930s. I know his heart. God's called us to restore it. It's one of weeping and crying over the loss, of presenting the trophies of Africans who used to bow down to idols, to the Lord. That's what he's doing now in the presence of God in heaven. And those who have infiltrated in have no idea of the submission and surrender of those days. And we say to you, hand it over to those who understand the things of the vision of Rees Howes. You see, Constitution Keepers is about keeping the vision of what God gave to founders. He never changes, and neither should the vision of any movement. Nations too, take notice. Our nation in Britain was never built on aborting babies. It was always built on bringing life, not death. Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord. He continues to say it. You know, by the time we finish with this plan, there's going to be a mighty revival of God. We understand there'll be every barrier placed in the way, but let me tell you, the word of God is mightier than anything the devil can put before us. We're here today to fulfill these purposes of God in his name, to go about doing good, healing all oppressed of the devil, because God is with us. And even though we go through these battlegrounds, we're declaring the victory of the Lord. A voice, verse 21, I'll come back to verse 14, was heard upon the high places, weeping and supplications of the children of Israel, for they have perverted their way. Let me tell you, give me viewers, we're bending down, I have a file here. Oh God, our nation in Britain, I know I'm bending down because I'm determined to get this out. This is the coronation service of Her Majesty the Queen. From 1953, the monarch today is coming all to all kinds of attack. She's appearing on the newspapers in Great Britain today doing a Nazi salute. She was 7 at the time, a little bit on 4 different days, but it's as if the monarchy is so much under attack, and I tell you why. Not because she was playing around as a child of 7. It's because the nation's been playing around with our constitution written in this book. And there is great evil coming upon Great Britain. ISIS is there in America. You'll understand exactly what I'm saying. I'm not building up ISIS to be anything. But I'm telling you, they represent one thing and one thing alone. Babylon. And Babylon is always there to place in captivity any nation which turns away from its God-given constitution. I give warning today to fulfill the purposes of God, and God has ordained Great Britain and America to be one together in the Lord. That's what the Mayflower Compact was all about, to understand what's in the constitution here of Britain and America. For the Pilgrim Fathers, where did they come from but Plymouth, England? And the whole, the spirit's just leading to, because I'm weeping, the ministry of tears and constitution keepers is one ministry. The Lord's leading to me to read this. From 1 Kings, we'll come to Jeremiah in just a moment, the weeping prophet. What did he weep over but his nation which turned away from God? What are we called to weep over? Our nation has turned away from God. I'm reading to you direct from the coronation service of Her Majesty the Queen, in which she proclaimed that she would declare the Protestant Reformed religion established by law, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that alone. She swore that to God in front of the whole nation and the world. And no one seems to want to look at the word she swore in 1953. But I'm going deeper than that. I'm going to look at the service around that oath, which took place in Westminster Abbey, London, England. This hymn was sung. Don't tell me Britain is a multi-faith country of equality and diversity. There's no equality and diversity law can take away this coronation service. It's nothing equal about it. There's only one faith, and one faith alone. The monarch being the defender of the faith, not faiths. Come, Holy Ghost, our hearts inspire with song. Enlighten with celestial fire. Thou the anointing spirit art, whose dust thy sevenfold gifts impart. Thy blessed unction. They were singing for the unction of God to come upon the monarch of the... Oh, I'm telling you, Lindsay, if this doesn't bring you to tears to see Britain today, they were singing in 1953 for the unction to come from above. Comfort, life, and fire, and love. enable with perpetual light the dullness of our blinded sight. Then from 1 Kings 1:39 and 40, Zadok the priest, the sons of Zadok who heard from God, the unction of God coming upon this priesthood for which the queen is coronated to be a part. Nathan the prophet, for the very coronation service of Her Majesty the Queen and all the monarchs of Great Britain was always based, going back to Reformation days, on the coronation of Solomon the King. Nathan the prophet anointed Solomon king, and all the people rejoiced and said, God save the king, long live the king, may the king live forever, amen, hallelujah. That's from the service. In the meantime, the queen rose from her devotions, which was based on the Zadok priesthood of 1 Kings 1:39 and 40. Having been disrobed of her crimson robe by the Lord Great Chamberlain, I'm just bending down for a tissue, because we weep over Britain. Assisted by the mistress of the robe, being uncovered, goes to the altar, supported, attended as before. She sits down in King Edward's chair, placed in the area over against the altar, wherein she's anointed. You know, when one is anointed with oil, this is a symbol of the Holy Ghost. There can be no multi-faith in here. God is a jealous God. By the hands anointed with holy oil, on the breast saying, by thy breast anointed with holy oil. On the crown of the head saying, by the head anointed with holy oil. As kings, priests, and prophets were anointed. As kings, priests. If you can't weep, as kings, priests, and prophets were anointed, so the head of state of Great Britain. And look at the state of the nation today. And as Solomon was anointed king by whom? Zadok the priest. It is those of the priesthood of Zadok who have given rites in the coronation oath, called the clergy of the Protestant Reformed religion, who are called to ensure that this oath and this service is kept to. This is our role at ecctv.org, is to remind movements of the visions of the founder. Those in the Reformation looked to have a king or queen in Great Britain as of Solomon. And as Solomon was anointed king by Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet, so be thou anointed. Same anointing. You're dealing with fire when you break this. And I'm weeping for you, Great Britain. Politicians, please hear me. I'm a local politician in Colwyn Bay. We soul on a town council. And I'm talking to you with tears in my eyes out of love for you all, whether you're Labour, Conservative, Plaid Cymru, SNP, Liberal, Democrat, whatever you may be, even the beast of Bolsover. I'm speaking to you today. We love you. This is not a political speech. This is a God speech. This is constitution. We're a ministry of a charity. We're not here to to give party political broadcasts. This is way beyond politics. You've broken your constitution, Great Britain. And you come chasing the... You always do. Israel chased Jeremiah. He put him down in a well. Whenever there's a break of a constitution, the prophets always get blamed. They always get persecuted. We know we're going through that. We go through legal action after legal action. We need your support, everybody. If you could let us, I mean, just let me tell you, it's costing thousands over the years. I said to a dear friend of many years from Stoke-on-Trent today, I said, Tony, it must have cost us £500,000. Mm-hmm. But it's worth it. Can we bring our nation back to God? This is a nation which killed baby after baby. This is not as of Solomon. Am I right in saying he had two babas brought to him?
Two women with one baby.
Lindsay's putting me right. Fighting over one baby. I knew there was two there. Two women and one baby. His heart was for that baby to go to the right mother. He was wise. Would he have seen that baby killed and slaughtered? Yet this monarch has overseen since the 1967 Abortion Act. Child after child sucked out of womb, screaming in pain, and brought into the hands of Jesus. I don't find this in the coronation service. I'm just reading another part here. Part which covers the creed. One Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son of God. Yet we've got equality and diversity legislation. Everybody's equal now. All the religions are, no. The creed was read at the coronation service. Only begotten Son of God, only. Begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God. Begotten, not made, one substance with the Father, by whom all things made. They said that and they're letting in the philosophies of Satan, the lifestyles of Satan, to overturn that which was spoken in 1953. Can you not cry today? And as Solomon was anointed king by Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet, so be thou anointed. In every court her crest is above the judge's chair. Be thou anointed. As the queen was anointed with the anointing as was on Solomon, so every judge in the land is technically anointed because that judge is representing the monarch. The crest is above his or her head. Do you not know the responsibility you have? Consecrated queen over all the peoples whom the Lord thy God hath given thee to rule and govern. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, no other name. You know, in the days of Jeremiah, Israel, like Britain and America, had turned away from God. Verse 21 of verse 3 again, a voice was heard upon the high places, weeping and supplications. This is what we do in this ministry. We have this team of intercessors of many years. Sheila Standish, who's still right with us. She's in a nursing home now. Right with us. People are saying all kinds of things about her and her relationship with us, but they don't know her. They don't know us. We're needing to go into the police this weekend to deal with the false accusations. We've had a wonderful team over the years of Margaret, Lindsay, Sheila, and Marjorie. In the high places of supplications. You've done a wonderful job. It's been under attack of late. Mm-hmm. It's been so difficult of late. We've had legal case after legal case, preventing us from going forward. Oh, we got to deal with all kinds of stuff. Page after page, Lindsay's been going through. The British Office of Public Guardian have made all kinds of accusations. Yet they don't know Sheila. They don't know the calling on her life. They don't know the calling on these intercessors. We're now to go along and say what it's all about. It's about a ministry of tears, of forsaking all we have to reach the lost. That's what it's all about. A voice was heard upon the high place. Are you weeping today? You see, this program's about the ministry of tears. Unless you're going to weep, you're not going to save no one. You know, it's not a technical formula, as in Alpha, just saying the so-called sinner's prayer doesn't even include repentance in that God-forsaken course. Oh yeah, we're pulling it all down. We're going to build up with a ministry of tears and the brokenness. Are you broken today? I am. What Lindsay and I have been through, we love each other so much over 30 years. I would say we love each other more today than when we first met. It's increased, it hasn't decreased. She's my precious wifey, I love so much. Because we're in covenants, there's not a word you don't understand today. And with Marjorie and Sheila and Margaret, we've been in covenants over many, many years. It's as if we're all married to each other. Don't get that wrong. It's not in the physical sense, in the spiritual sense. We're married to each other. We're all joined together as one. And we weep over the way nations of the world, forgive me, and bend me down again and get my box of tissues. No. We had threats against us. When you move in this, you do. Calling these tears crocodile tears. Well, I'm telling you, I dare say a crocodile can cry. When it sees its family being destroyed. And the British Commonwealth in America have been a family of nations over many years. And we see it all being destroyed. But in verse, Marjorie's looking at it deeply here, Jeremiah 3 and 22. There's opportunity to return. You know, didn't it say in 14, turn, O backsliding children? And doesn't it say here, return, ye backsliding children? And I will heal your backsliding. That's a promise. Can you come back? Great Britain, can you come back? United States, can you come back? Canada, Australia, New Zealand, African countries, India. You know, there was something special about the British Empire. I know there was things went wrong. I know. Don't tell me. I know. But there were a lot of good things too. And the greatest thing of the British Empire was the fact that missionaries could go out into empire countries and bring about a great revival. Now God would have the people of these countries to come back to us in Britain, yet all kinds of legal problems are there to stop it happening because the devil don't want it to happen, because that's the reaping to the sowing. Behold, we come unto thee, for thou art the Lord our God. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet. And he called for repentance. Because the consequences of not repenting were dire. He said in chapter 4, verse 9, to come to pass to that day, saith the Lord, the heart of the king shall perish, and the heart of the princes, the priests shall be astonished, and the prophets shall wonder. That's exactly what's happened in Britain. They forget it now. The years of the Diana troubles were because the nations turned away from God and she didn't know whether she was coming or whether she's going. I knew her mother, lovely lady, Frances Ann Kidd. She was a customer of mine when I was a sales rep in Scotland. I loved that dear lady, but she suffered greatly. We need to have a nation on its knees before God. Had the marriage between Charles and Diana been on its knees before God and surrendered to God, then the troubles which beset that marriage would never have happened. Back to chapter 3. The Spirit's just keeping me in Jeremiah. I hadn't planned this. Turn, O backsliding, because I'm married to you. This coronation service of Great Britain, Marjorie and Margaret, Margaret's just nipped out to go somewhere. Marjorie and Lindsay. This is a marriage service with God. Mm-hmm. It is. Can you see it? The coronation service. I can hardly put this down. It's so anointed of God. Remind me, Lindsay, to take this into the police this week when we go to see them. Let me show it to them. Because this is what Sheila was all about. Being married to the Lord. It's what we are all about. And a marriage is a total giving of one to another. It's called covenant. And you give everything you've got for this calling. And that's what Sheila did. Now they question that heart. It's all here in the coronation service. A total giving of one nation to God. Yet like with Jeremiah, once you become the conscience of a nation, that nation will come after you. Or repent. Margaret's coming back now. A voice was heard upon the high places, weeping and supplication of the children of Israel. Return, O backsliding children. Then in verse 14, I am married to you. I will take you one of a city and two of a family, and I will bring you to Zion. I'll bring you pastors according to mine own heart. The pastors we've exposed today of Elam, Assemblies of God, Nazarene, Baptist churches, you have moved off your own heart, not God's own heart, because that is to keep the landmark of the founders. If you are in Elam, you're to preach the four square gospel, Jesus, Savior, Healer, Baptizer, Holy Ghost, soon coming King. If you're a Baptist, the message of Spurgeon. If you're a Methodist, the message of Wesley on entire sanctification. You're not at liberty to preach anything else but that which your founder brought about for the common good of all the people. To do anything else is of the rebellious witchcraft, which has come in practically every movement, every nation in the world. And unless you turn, then the judgment of God will come, and it's coming right now. For unless you understand these words, you will see judgment like you've not seen judgment before. That what you're seeing in the world at this time is nothing until you come to realize that the protection of God will be upon your nation on condition that you have kept your holy covenant with him. Now, I've told you, not out of malice, out of nastiness, but out of love and conviction, out of tears. For the promise is there, if you come back, I'll give you pastors according to mine own heart. Isn't it there, Marjorie? Feed you with knowledge and understanding. That's what this ministry is all about. That's why we have the Bible College of Wales continuing to feed you with knowledge and understanding of God's word. And government departments after government departments, you don't even know it. And our college is here to give you free courses for you to receive and understand that as in the coronation service, there's only one God, only one begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. That's what this ministry of tears is all about. I am married to you, saith the Lord. And I'm closing now, not too long a message. Lindsay's going to come up and sing the old rugged cross made the difference. I'm closing now. I'm married to you. 1 Corinthians 6:17. I'm trying to find it in time, but I know it in my spirit. Those joined to the Lord are one spirit. But there the warning is, as in Jeremiah, Israel had fornicated itself. It had gone after other gods. It had gone after other lifestyles. It had gone after other idols and turned away from its covenant with God. And the weeping prophets cried and cried and cried. The intercessors were on the hills in supplications, weeping and pulling down the strongholds so the nation could return to its covenant with God. There it is in verse 15. Know ye not. Remember, this coronation service is a marriage servant service of a nation with God. Know ye not your bodies are the members of, we have equality and diversity. There's no equality and diversity in this service. There's one only begotten Son. Shall I then take the members of Christ, make them the members of a harlot? God forbid. Know ye not, he which is joined to a harlot is one body, for two, saith he, shall be one flesh. Great Britain, America, Commonwealth countries, you're joined to a harlot and you need to repent before God. Get on your knees, never mind national days of prayer. National fortnights of repentance is in order for what you've done before Almighty God by slaughtering those innocent children day after day, hour after hour, minute after minute. Flee fornication. Know ye not your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, ye are not your own. How do I know that? Because the parliament is not a democratic parliament. You don't even know that. Why do you think you have prayers before every sitting of the House of Commons and House of Lords? So the Spirit of God should give you guidance, because you're not your own. You're not there to have your opinion. You're there to have God's and his alone. That's why you swear on the King James Bible to be an MP. You don't know why you're there. What's it say in this coronation service? What's it say? It says the judges are the clergy of the Protestant Reformed religion side by law. You've got all your judges and all your systems to oversee church ministries. You're illegal. It's in here. It's in the coronation oath. The rights are given of overseeing to the clergy and bishops of the realm. And what's it say in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 2? Do you not know the saints shall judge the world? I tell you. We've had legal case, regulation after regulation. Don't you know the saints will judge the world? The letter of the law killeth, the spirit giveth life. Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more, therefore, things that pertain to this life? We have been under legal onslaught. The BBC, the Office of Public Guardian, the police, Conwy County Borough Council, trying to count anyone else, Court of Protection, all gathering around this ministry with all kinds of accusations. The Word says if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? You know, the case we're talking about is a holy covenant, a holy case relating the forsaking of a lady to give her all into a ministry to reach every creature with the gospel. Yet they make all kinds of accusations. Know ye not, it's the saints that judge the world. Mm. We better take that along this week, Lindsay. Mm. Chapter 6. Mm. The saints that judge the world. And it's there in the coronation oath of Her Majesty the Queen. And it's law above every other law. Won't they be pleased? Because we're going to apply that. In this case, in any other case they put against us. It's not for us to be the defendants. And for those who are of the Ashes Bakery in Belfast, you can contact us, 01492544451. All the cases all over the world, Christians are losing at this time. Let me tell you this, it's the saints that judge the world. And it's there. I'm going to take this and I'm going to put it in. Maybe see the police this week. I'm going to take this in 1 Corinthians 6 and say, look, I've got something to show you. It's the saints that judge the world. You want to take this on? It's the saints that judge the world. And Jeremiah was judging Israel way back. We've been reading in the early chapters, the weeping prophets. They attacked him, attacked him, attacked him. But he was the conscience of Israel. And they attack us and attack us and attack us, but we are the conscience of Great Britain and America and the Commonwealth countries. Will you join us in this ministry of tears? You know, so much more I could talk about here. I think more will come out tomorrow. We've had attack on this ministry, on its equipment. We're back now in high definition. You know, I couldn't even bear to come and live stream to you in standard definition. It wasn't even standard, it was substandard definition, really. As some of you watched Dear Brian's programs probably saw, we were having real technical issues, which we found a way to deal with them, that we're now on high definition. You know, we have a high definition God, so we need a high definition picture, you know. I'm glad that we're live streaming. And if you're on YouTube, you just go to that little button there, just left click it, and you can readjust it from 480p to 1080p high definition. You like a lovely picture. But more importantly, we have a lovely God who sent his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him. And he bore our griefs and our sorrows, our sins, our sicknesses, disease. Mm-hmm. He bore them on the tree of Calvary. Mm-hmm. Lovely old hymn, lest I forget Gethsemane. Lest I forget his love for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane. Oh, we must never forget Gethsemane. Of the toil and torment of the Savior who was going to the cross to bear our every disease and every sickness and every infirmity and every sin. He bore and every curse became the curse. Cursed is the one who is nailed to the tree. And in the place of the skull, Golgotha, his life was shed for us. His blood was drained from his veins, pouring down his face, his matted hair, beard. If you don't know this Savior, let me tell you, there's no one like him. He took your sin and your sorrow. Born of his very own. He took them. You see the modern emerging churches, none of this. People say it's emotional. It's not emotional. It's the Savior's blood. And you know, the veil was broken in two. And that access to the very Holy of Holies of God came because of his suffering and his torment and his precious blood. That through his blood, I was saved. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, you know. Can't come to the Savior. And all my dear friends in Islam, in Hinduism, and I call you friends, Buddhism, whatever it may be, bless your dear hearts, but you haven't a Savior who shed his blood for you. It's not me being unpleasant. You know, you have your choice to make, but let me recommend to you the Savior who took your sins. You know, I was with a dear man in Stoke-on-Trent some years ago now. And I said, what assurance have you of salvation? And he said, well, it's all in the will of Allah. He wasn't sure whether he'd go to paradise or not. And I asked the rabbi, what assurance have you got of salvation? And likewise, he said, it's all in the will of God. He had no assurance. And the reason for that is assurance can only come through the blood of the Savior. You can have this assurance today that your life will be in eternity with Jesus, the one who shed his blood for you. As Lindsay comes and sings the song, the old rugged cross made the difference from a life of heartache and despair. Let us not forget in Britain the oath of the monarch and the coronation service, as how this was a reenactment of the anointing which God placed on Solomon, and how the nation is obligated to hear constantly from God. This is our ministry of tears. Future weeks we'll be going round the world you know, God has on my heart Tamil people. Hearing of Pastor Jacob and his dear wife Susie, who we knew, who loved. And that service next week, if you can go to Revival Christian Worship Center, go there. There'll be tears there too. But joy unspeakable. For she's with her Savior. And you could be with him today if only you repent and accept him into your heart and life. Will you do that today? Will you accept this Savior? You may be dead tomorrow, facing an eternity in hell flames. But let me tell you, I can tell you of a Savior who died to save you from all of that. I recommend to you the Savior Jesus. There's no one like him. He'll take over your life. And you'll think of others before yourself. Come unto him today. The old rugged cross made the difference. Lindsay, my dear wife, is going to come up and sing this lovely song. Come on, Lindsay.
Yes,
come on.
Dear.
We sing together. She's my dear wife. He's looking very smart today.
Thank you.
And we praise him. We got Marjorie and Margaret with us. We'd show you them, but we only got one camera and one cameraman, and I'm the cameraman and the sound man and the preacher. So it's just take my word for it, they're here. Will you come to this Savior? Come by way of this cross.
Mm-hmm.
You can come to him now. Because this cross made the difference.
Hallelujah. Thank you, David. This message will continue tomorrow at 2 p.m. with the On Fire Constitution Keepers, 2 p.m. UK time. And it's all about the cross and Jesus. The old rugged cross made the difference. And there's a room at the cross for you. I think we've got another song there called The Haven of Rest. Just wait a wee minute. Praise the Lord. He is our haven of rest. And he calms the storm. This is the one. The old rugged cross made the difference.
I got the right button in the end, Lindsay. Come to the Savior. This Jesus is yours today. We love you, Lord Jesus. Lindsay, sing it with all of your heart.
T'was a life filled with this desperation, without hope, what a shame of a man. Then I heard with the nail point stretched downward, just one touch and a new life began, and the old rugged cross made the difference. Pain alone, bound for heartache and defeat. I will praise him forever and ever, for the cross made the
praise you, Lord Jesus.
Barren walls echoed harshness and anger. Little feet ran in terror to
love, warmth, and laughter.
Now those walls ring with love, warmth, and laughter.
You could come today.
Since the giver of life moved in soul, filled with salvation faces, without whom death has left them. But the soul of a saint is rejoicing for life and be sealed in a tomb. And the old rugged cross
Hallelujah. Lindsay, don't go away. You know, these are new programs at this time. And it's like a new season for ECCTV.org, Every Creature Commissioned Television. Brian Mason has been called to have two new programs, The Blood of Jesus and Holy Fire, as well as continuing Reese Howell's intercession, which is the whole heart of this ministry. Identifying with those who are lost, to understand what so many have been through. This station is one of heart, not intellect or mental suggestion or mental persuasion, but one of the Spirit of God. Station that declares the Lordship of Christ, and that this cross did make the difference. And then on Wednesdays, we have Maynard James, Holiness Preacher on Fire, continuing these vintage recordings which are so powerful and anointed. And you need to be entirely sanctified. It comes up every week on the program, that conviction of God. And our dear sister Margaret here, who's been longing to do her programs and all kinds of issues, have been stopping them. We're looking to get her back this week. And then dear Marjorie is going through a battle at this time. The Lord's going to speak to her and build her up to be stronger than what she's ever been. You see, we go through the battlegrounds too here. Times I think I'm going to prison, because we're just alien to what the world understands. But then something from inside of me says, greater is he who is in you than he that's in the world. And the Lord is having us restore ministers at this time as well. But we need you, our viewers, to contact us. From overseas, 00441492544551. From UK, 01492544551. We need you. We want you to contact us. Please contact us. You can email us at ecctv4219@gmail.com. It's on your screen now. You can see our email address. You know, this old rugged cross has made a difference to us all. And I love these words where it says, now those walls ring with love, warmth and laughter. And this is what follows the tears. And as we're open with each other, one of the latest stages of this Holy Ghost business plan is the open confession movement that will come. You know, I've even had someone come and confess to me over terrible things which they've been tormented with in their lives. And I'm telling you this, there's a Savior. There's only one Savior who can save you from those torments, and His name is Jesus. Come to Him today. We love you. Thank you for joining us on ecctv.org. And join us tomorrow, please. 10:30 UK time. Brian Mason has a further new program, The Price and Power of Revival. Prayer 2. And then tomorrow afternoon, in glorious HD, On Fire Constitution Keepers. And remember that website, constitutionkeepers.org. For the breakers are of the sin of witchcraft. Those who keep the covenant are of God, and they are to be the judges of nations. We give Jesus all the praise and all the glory. Lindsay, will you wave to everyone goodbye? Thank you for being with us. God bless you. See you soon. Midnight Cries Ministry of Tears program was presented through the empty vessels of David and Lindsay Griffiths. And as I've just said, we do long to hear from you. You can find us at ecctv.org, but we want to hear from you. ecctv4219@gmail.com. You can phone us at 01492 534 51. From UK, and from overseas, 0044-1492-5444-51. And please see our seven-year plan. You'll find it at ecctv.org. And as the Spirit of the Lord leads, join us in intercessory prayer. Embrace the seven-year plan. Respond to the Spirit of God in your offerings to the Lord through this ministry. We thank you all for joining us. This is David and Lindsay Griffiths, and also in the studio, Margaret Transfield and Marjorie Bynum. We thank you for being with us today. We praise the name of the Lord Jesus of Nazareth. We give Him all the glory. The anointing is so strong in this room, and we bless you and thank you for being with us. And don't forget, everybody, next week, at the Revival Christian Center in Trichy, India, the first anniversary memorial service for our dear sisters, Reverend Professor Susie Jacob. We thank the Lord and praise the Lord for their life and ministry, and we give Jesus all the praise and all the glory. And we pray, Father, a mighty anointing next week in that wonderful worship center there in Trichy. A mighty anointing, we pray, as they all remember the wonderful life of Susie Jacob. We give Jesus all the praise and we give Him all the glory. Goodbye, everybody. We love you. God bless you.
rushing wind, and it's close for now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call, and at the midnight cry we'll be going home. When Jesus steps out on a cloud for his children, and then those that do believe.